Yeah. Okay. Myself is Soumya Paul. I'm basically from Kamagiri Kollegal Taluk. It's in Karnataka. And presently, I'm residing in Bangalore. I was in Mysore for during my education. So I'm not from Mysore. I was in Mysore, that's it.
Okay.
So as I'm from Christian, yeah, as from I was I'm from Christian family. It's just like a habit. Everyone knows that habit every day, like going to church, Sunday school, and memorizing the Bible verses. And in the Sunday school, we'll sing the song, right? Praise him in the morning, praise him in the noontime, praising in the night. It was like that. Getting up, praying, afternoon praying. Night also before going to bed, reading the Bible and praying. And in the year 1998, I accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as my personal Savior through the word Romans 10:9. It says, if you confess from your mouth that Jesus is your Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead. So this word, through this word, I accepted Lord Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. And in 2003, I got baptized. Being from the Christian family, it was not so difficult for me to accept Lord Jesus Christ and get baptism also. But when the day passes, one brother had come to my home. He asked my father whether you have a Bible study or prayer meeting, family prayers like that and all. So my father said, yes, we have it in the night before going to bed. We will, as a family, we'll sit together and we'll have a Bible study and we'll have prayer and all, he said. Then he asked, what about in the morning? Then my father said, morning we will all be busy. So children needs to go for the colleges, schools and all. And even we have to go for work. So morning we will be having self prayer. So brother asked advised us to have the prayer before we leave our house. So I was in the hostel. After completing my 10th, I joined the hostel. Almost 10 to 15 years I was in the hostel itself before I was getting before my marriage. So I went back to my hostel and I wanted to go for shopping, like I wanted to buy slipper. So suddenly I remembered what brother had told, like before you stepping out, you have to pray and go. It's good to pray and go. So I just remembered and I prayed. So I thought I will pray and go. Just I asked God, God, I'm going out to buy slipper. Please be with me while going and coming. That's it. But when I went to buy the slipper, you may feel like what this Akka is telling, like she's going to buy slipper and she's mentioning in this testimony like that. But really, my dear sisters who are here, see, God really helped me. So that time I was doing my master's. So we had some financial crisis too in the family too, and I had taken education loan for my studies and all. So for me, I had only 200 rupees and I want to buy, and the 200 rupees also was so important for me. But when I went to buy the slipper, I got it for 150, which is a good quality, the durability, everything was good, and more than that, it satisfied me a lot. And I realized it happened just because of the prayer. You believe it or not, it's only just because of the prayer. We to go for the shopping, and if you want to buy so many things, we do get attracted. So we will be get attracted by seeing other things, and so if we want to buy with the 200, sometimes because like we will be get tempted, and we want to buy with the much more higher price. So like that, it is to vary. But it gave me such a satisfaction that day. From that day, I realized prayer is so powerful and so important. And I started to do all my works, all my things through prayer. When I started doing the things through prayer, I have really, I have seen the wonderful things in my life. And I was not so good at studies. Good in the sense I was not with a like an average students, like a bit higher than the average students. Like I used to score above 70 and below 80. It is maybe between 70 to 75% like that. Not with a too high scorer. I was not too high scorer. But still, God helped me in all these years. So when I kept my prayer as the first thing, so for my exam, when I was preparing for my exams, like I used to pray and prepare. So in the last, not last, before last week, while giving the testimony, like 3 G's, I think Grace, while giving her testimony, she mentioned that mathematics she got flunked and things like that. So you can ask you all the youngsters. You can take my these points like key points or it may help you out. Like first, when I sit for studies, I used to pray with the five things. I used to pray with the five things. That first thing, I used to ask God, God, I'm going to study now. Please be with me and give me the knowledge, because God himself have told, if you lack knowledge, ask me, I will give you sufficiently. So I was asking God. I asked God to give me the knowledge. Second thing, I used to ask God that, God, whatever I'm going to study, let it be in my mind, because I should not forget, right? It should be, everything should be stored in my mind. And the third thing I used to ask God, whatever I've studied, let those things only come in the exam. So everything will be in my mind, fine. But if in case those questions won't come to the exam, so I used to ask God, let those questions only come in the exam. And when I'm going to write the exam, I used to ask God, God, let whatever I've studied in, let it be in the mind, and let I remember everything, whatever they have asked in the exam, let I write everything. I attempt all the questions and I should write all the answers without forgetting a single word. I need to write. And the last thing I used to ask, that God, make me to pass in the first attempt with the first class marks. Really, the God has worked and he has blessed me with a very good marks. So in the up to graduation, I was an average student. But when I came for my master's, it's like I was with the second topper to the college. So it is just because of the God. It's a God's work. And another thing, what I want to mention along with this prayer, when 5 days left for my exam, I used to stop speaking with my friends, my roommates and all, because I don't want to get any kind of distraction during exam time. So in case if my friends speak about the subject, it will be at the end moment, it will be kind of confusion. So I don't want to get any kind of distraction, or in case if they speak out of the subject, it is going to disturb my mind. I can't concentrate on my studies. So I used to stop speaking with my friends. Even my friend used to tell, during exam time, some devil will come on her. So she won't speak with anyone. So she will behave like this. But let they think whatever they want. But my concentration was on my studies, because my study was very important, because I have taken education loan. So the bank manager had told me, if you won't score good marks, if you get flunk and all, they are going to cancel the loan amount. So it was very important. But by God's grace, I cleared the exams with a very beautiful marks. So prayer is very, very important. So as it says in Colossians 4:25, pray earnestly. So you pray, definitely God is going to give you, whether it is a small or big thing. You ask, definitely he will give. When you are going to be with God, when praying, speaking, praying is nothing but speaking with God. When you are walking with God, even the Satan work will also be with the same kind. So like if you remember Job, so Satan, he was very good to God, and Satan was also behind him. So he was keep on testing him. So in the same way, in our lives also, there will be a lot of ups and downs, especially in my life. As a girl, as a female, whatever the problem a girl can face in this world, in this society, I have come across all types of situations, ups and downs, all the obstacles I have faced in all these days of my life. But God is so good, and he was with me and he had helped me. But I did two mistakes in with this regard. When I was undergoing some lot of obstacles in my life, I shared these things with my friend. So I told my friend, see, this is what happening, all these things. When I said to her, she listened to me everything. She's an unbeliever. She's Hindu. She listened to me everything. And she said, see, you will be always reading the Bible. You will be praying. You won't come with us for the theater and all when we are going further. And you will be always speaking about Jesus, you God, like that you will be. And see what Jesus has done to you. So when she said like that, I felt so sad, and it was like a hit on my face. So, and I realized I did a mistake, that I shared the things with the unbeliever, and she is going to speak instead of me. She could have scolded me, but she is telling about my God. I felt so bad, and that day I realized, so we should not. It has mentioned with the in Matthew 7th chapter 15 verse, beware of false prophet, or not to get mingle with the unbelievers. So we have a difference, right? Sorry, in the 2 Corinthians 6:14, it says, not equally woke together with unbelievers. So there is a difference between righteous and unrighteousness. There is a difference between light and the dark. So I realized those words on that day. And I was in a confusion. So I was praying, but still I didn't get particular answer. I was not so satisfied what to do. Like, my mind was not stable. I don't know what to do. The things were not working so well. After a couple of days, one aunt called me. She's also a believer. She's like, she's also my relative. She can consider as my relative. So she called me and she was speaking to me. And she came to know that something is happening with me. And she was insisting me to tell what is that, like that and all. But I don't wanted to share anything with her. But still she insisted, and I shared few things with her. She listened everything, and she consoled me, and she, okay, don't worry, everything will be fine. We'll pray for you, like that and all, she said. And after a couple of days, I got to know, whatever she listened from me, she started telling to everyone, especially to my relatives and all. So I felt so bad, and I remembered the verse what I told before, that Matthew 7:7, beware of false prophet. So you don't know how they are coming with a sleep's clothing. So I felt like that it was. So I took a wrong decision. I did two mistakes. One, I shared with unbeliever, and second thing with the wrong believer. So these two, and I was in a confusion. I was praying God what to do and all. And I had been to Malwali. God gave me an opportunity to go to Malwali for women's meeting. And when I was in the meeting, I met Hani aunty over there. So till I remember, Hani aunty was giving the message about Ruth, Naomi and Ruth. So the message what auntie was giving, no? So I felt, yes, I can speak to the auntie. I can speak with her, not sharing. I thought of speaking to auntie about something, like we'll see whether it is right to speak to her like that. But it's really the God's work only, because otherwise I would have not gone to Malwali. I would have not spoken to aunt also, because I know so many aunties over there, so many speakers, those who are going to come over there, I know them. But I didn't felt like speaking and sharing the things. But when I spoke to auntie, I felt comfortable. And I just shared my things with her. Auntie had consoled me. I gave a spiritual thing. See, this is very important, my dear sisters who are here. When you're going to share your things, think before you share. So with whom you're going to share is matters a lot, because it is going to spoil your testimony. It's not only like they are going to notice whether you are a true Christian or not, and they may spoil your name also. So you have to be very careful. And if you want to share, you share with the person with whom you're comfortable, and you pray before you're going to speak to others. Pray earnestly. God will show you the way with whom you have to speak. And it is not like auntie's here and I'm telling this one. So whenever I come across some problem, whenever I have some confusion, I used to call auntie. But auntie really attends my call, and really auntie is just a spiritual mother, I can say. So really we need one person in our life like that. So I'm very thankful to auntie. And as the day passes, this is not the end of my testimony. Still, it is there. It is just an half. And the next is, after a few days, we had, when I was in master degree only, we had a special meeting in my native for 3 days meeting. brother Reginald Solomon is from Bangalore. He had come to my native and he was sharing the word of God, and he was speaking about the Jesus crucifixion. And he was speaking about what Jesus, seven words, what Jesus had told on the cross. And the fourth word, the middle word, that is Matthew 27:16, it says, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? So this word was disturbing me a lot, because in John 3:16, it says, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Only one son he gave for us, right? But the same son is in trouble and he's calling, my God, why you forsaken me? See, God forsaken his own son. Instead of holding his son's hand, he holded our hand, right? My hand. So I'm unworthy. I'm not a good person. So I'm a sinner, the one who was in the pit. So God wanted me to save. God looked at me instead of looking at Jesus. So this word disturbed me a lot. And I realized that God sent Jesus for my sake. And Jesus did his work and he went. And he has promised that he is going to come back again. And he is sitting next to God and he is praying for us. Then what I am doing now? Why I am here? What I am supposed to do? So all these things came to my mind. And that day, it was my real salvation. So my baptism, when I accepted the Lord Jesus, it was nothing. But I accepted my salvation was true on that particular day. That day, I decided to surrender myself before the God. I submitted before the God and I decided I have to do something for God. For that purpose, I am here. See, in the John 15:16, it says, you have not chosen me, but God has chosen us, right? So why he has chosen us? To live for his glory. So whatever we do, whether we eat or drink, we have to do for the glory of God. So I realized those words and I decided and I dedicated myself to God. Next, what I'm supposed to do? How I can do my service? So I'm not such a good singer also. I don't have guts to go and speak, give the message also. What to do? I was so disturbed. By the time I had completed my master degree and I was at home for 5 to 6 months. So God gave me the opportunity. I didn't have any plan of going for the teaching field, but God gave me the opportunity to work in the PU college. Later, one sister came from the degree college for some program and she told, so only 10 months it was, not even I completed that particular academic year. She told me, like, you have to come and join my institution for degree for the BBM department. You have to take up the classes like that, she said. Then I said, oh, okay. And after that, I went and joined the degree college. Really, it's a blessing. It's only the God's work. See, God had showed me the way. So God will make a way. We know that song, right? It's a very beautiful song. The same way, God showed me the way where I'm supposed to go. So I just went there. And it's God's work that I met a beautiful principal. I have to remember her. I have to tell about her. Her name is Sister Joyce. And she was 58, 59 by the time when I went over there. 1 year service was there. That's it. And she's so good. And as I'm from Kamagere, there also I stayed in the hostel. While working also, I was in the hostel. But my hostel was within the campus. So after the college, I used to go to hostel. So there only I can see my principal. The sister's convent used to be there. So my principal was so good that she is very much interested in all these community services. She involved herself in this social activity. She used to visit old age home, hospital. She used to pray for the patients, old age persons. And like that and all, she used to go for the prison and all. And she used to spend most of the time only in the prayers and she used to counsel the staffs and their families if in case if they have trouble and all. So as I was close to her, and every day I will be in the hostel, so in the college, so we became very close. And always I see sister telling like, I want to go to prison, I have prison visit, like that end of. Then I ask sister, I want to visit prison. So everyone will like to see how the prison will be, how the prison and the cell, how the prisoners dress, inmates dress and their plates. So everyone will be having that image, right? The same kind I had. And I asked sister, I want to visit the prison once. After a couple of days, she called me and she asked me to give my photo, passport size photo. I gave. And then the next day she called me, see, your ID card is ready. This evening at 3:30, be ready. Auto will come. We'll go to prison, she said. I was so excited. I called my parents. I told my colleagues, my friends, everyone that I'm going to prison, like that. I went to the prison. While entering, like, we have to keep all our belongings at the entrance itself. And next we have to go inside. But we're supposed to go only for the women's cell. So sisters from different congregation, different places, they had come over there. And three or four color ladies were there, but that day they were absent. And I was the only one with the color and the ink. I was ink that time, ink girl. So when I went inside, everyone were looking at me and the sisters, and they started wishing. Everyone were wishing. The prisoners were also, they were wishing. And I can see the prisoners with the white saris. So the convicted with the white saris, and those who are in trial in the sense, those cases still it has not been settled. So they were in color dresses. So we went inside. They gave the chairs to sit, and in front of us, all the prisoners came and gathered, and they were all sitting. And sister and the other sister told them to sing the song. So they sang two or three songs. After that, I was sitting next to my principal. My principal gave me the Bible, and she told me to read First Peter chapter 5 from 12 to 32. She told me to read loudly, clearly, so that everyone can listen. So I read it. Then afterwards, she told me, explain it. I was shocked to hear she's asking me to explain, but I knew that word, that Peter and apostles, they were in the prison. So I explained about it. And then sister told me after that to pray for them. And I prayed. And after the prayer, everything over. So each prisoner used to come and speak to us. And they used to share their problems. And they used to ask individual prayers. And they were asking, keep your hand and pray for us. Like my family members, they are not coming to see us. My case is still in the court. Pray like that. And after that, we came out. So 3:30 to 5 is our permission to be in the prison. We came out from the prison. Then my principal introduced me to other congregation sister and said, she is our staff from the Theresian College. And like that. Then they said, yes, she spoke well. She read the Bible well. She explained it well. She prayed also well. So let her take the in charge like that. Then they decided, and my principal told, every week you have, it's your in charge, that you have to come prepare with one passage and you have to lead the prayer service like that. I was shocked because I was asking my principal that I want to visit the prison only one time. Once I want to see. But God has given me, blessed and given me the opportunity to visit twice a week. That is Wednesday and Saturday, except on second Saturday. So do I am worthy for it? Can I give the message? Can I explain? See, when I accepted the Lord and when I submitted, when I decided I want to do something for God, God himself showed the way and gave me the opportunity to do so. And when the day passes, I got to know that the prisoners' children's above 3 years, they will be kept in the Jubilion. Minor prisoners and these children's where will be in the Jubilion, that means remand room. So I asked one lady to take me to remand room once. And it was also close by to my institution, and I had gone there. The superintendent was very good, and I spoke to the children also. And superintendent told me to visit frequently so that you can let they get counseled and let they come in a good way like that. But the situation is not so good, but their condition, their social background is completely different. Their thoughts, their things, they are very aggressive, they are very arrogant, but still God has given me the opportunity to serve among these children. So I used to go to the remand room. I used to pray for those children. I used to spend time with them. I used to tell the stories to them. I used to pray for them. And I used to teach some action song and all. And I referred some churches in Mysore. They wanted to go for the outreach program. Kind they want to conduct. I got permission. I took permission from the superintendent for them. And even they too had visited and they too had spent time with those children and all. And even one more sister in my college was there. She belongs to the psychology department. And their convent have orphanage. So she had taken me over there to the orphanage children, because some children, they were in the confusion. They don't know what to do and what not to do and all. And if the sisters tell to them, speak to them, they used to take it in a negative way because they are nuns and their ways and their life is completely different when compared to the normal one. So she asked me to be visiting to them like that and all, and she introduced me to them and all. So I was happy with these things, and not only with outside the college but inside the college too. Before I begin the class, I used to pray, I used to speak, I used to share the word of God with my students also. Every week we used to have one value education hour, so that hour I completely utilized for sharing the word of God. So like this, I was utilizing my complete time for the glory of God. God himself had given this opportunity. And if you want to do some program, always I used to begin my program with the invocation song, that our ill songs and Bible reading I used to keep. So only these things. So through the program also, I was looking for the opportunity where I can share the word of God to other people. So like this, God was using me. Then it comes. So this was quite a good things what was going on. But as a single, how long I can be a single? So in the last week, I think it's a testimony of Naomi, I think, right? Naomi Grace. Well, sharing, she was told, like a sister mentioned that she's 18. When she was 18, and they started searching for groom, and now she's 23. But my dear sister, but when I got married, I was 30 years. So in 30 years, and I had two confusions in my life. That is, either I have to go for the PhD, because I was doing my PhD. I had completed 2 years. And another thing, it was marriage. So where if I do my PhD, I do get doctorate and my career will be some other side. And if I get married, so my testimony, my witness before the society and before God, it will be fine. But I have to get the right person, right? So I had these two confusions. So when I was 27, my cousin got married. So in our wedding, so my cousin husband side, somebody, they saw me and they wanted to, they approached me. So their family and all, they were asking. So my cousin told, see, you get married because my husband, otherwise if you say no, my husband will feel bad. And my uncle was also telling the same thing because our son-in-law will feel bad. So I was not so interested to get into it, because when they came to see me, he said, you want to speak to me? And my parents said, okay, fine, you can speak. And when he came to speak to me, he asked me first, the first thing he asked me was, you have to change yourself because you have to get done with your eyebrows. You have to do the waxing and all, he said. Then I said, I'm not interested in all those stuff. Even I don't like putting nail polish also. So in doing all these things, it's quite difficult for me. And I don't think so. I don't like to do and all, I said. Then he said, I'm a bank manager. When I want to introduce you as my wife to other persons, you have to be according to that standard he was telling. And so I said, you are speaking about only these things. How about your spiritual life? I asked. Then he said, then Then he said, yes, we do have a family prayer every day at 9 o'clock. So 9 o'clock, wherever I am, I will sit and I will pray to God for a few minutes. So I was confused what kind of spirituality has got, and it was completely different. And I was not at all interested in doing these makeups. And even my relatives used to ask, my uncle was asking always, like, see other children, other you can see how much stylish they are being in the city for like after almost 10 to 12 years you have been in the city. Why don't you do so? I didn't feel like doing it also, because always it, in my mind it is to come that Genesis chapter 1 and 1 chapter 1 and 27 verse, it says God created man in his own image. That means we have created in his own image, and I don't wanted to alter that image. So, and it not only its own image, but if we continue reading, it says in the 31st verse, God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was good. It is not only good, behold, it was good, but in very beautiful. It's very clear that God, whatever he has done, it is good. That means he has created us and it is good. We don't want to make any changes, any alteration. And even I, for my wedding also, I didn't go to the parlor. I am not at all interested in those things and all. I didn't even go for that. Everyone were asking why you didn't go like that. But yeah, I was looking good that time also. So I was not bothered about it. So my parents were disturbed, like I didn't get married and all, especially my mom. When I told my dad about it, yeah, he's that guy, is that kind, okay, leave. But my mom, no, because of our cousin, my cousin and our brother and all, they were forcing me to get married because of her son-in-law. So she was quite disturbed. Then I took a firm decision, no. And in the when I was 28, my dad's sister's side, we got one proposal. I knew that guy also. Then I said, sisters and all, they came to my home and they were telling about that guy. I told, no, I don't want to get married to that guy. I don't even think of it, getting married to that guy. I don't like him at all. And I said, but when I was 30, I got married to the same guy. But I got married to the same guy. It's really a God's work. It's just a God's work, because I met him when I spoke to him, and when I shared that I have a commitment like this, and I will be visiting this prison, I'm going for the remand room, I'm going for the orphanage, I want to do the ministry and all, he gave me the positive feedback. He told, I will support you, you can do, you can go ahead. So I felt, yeah, this is the right guy. But the same guy I rejected 2 years before. So, but the same was the God's plan, and I got married at the age of 30 years. After the marriage also, I do keep on going for the prison ministries. And the last year during Christmas time, that holidays were there. No? So I had been to that jewel and remand room. I spent time with those children, and even the orphanage also. And we have involved ourselves. Like my husband is quite supportive with regard to the ministries. If you want to give something for the students, like if you want to give some gift for the prisoners also, he is very free enough to give. So it's just a God's grace. And that's not like after that, it's don't think that everything will be like this, everything will be comfortable. See, there will be always ups and downs in the life. So I don't want fan, but my husband want fan. So the small things and all will be there, ups and downs will be there. And even Satan work will also be there. I went on a lot of health issues. So when I was carrying, so when it was 8 months, like I had lost fluid and my condition was very critical. So when, and I was hospitalized, I had been to my native and there only I was hospitalized. And really God has blessed me all these days with a beautiful like principal, beautiful doctor, guide, mentors, like that only. So the doctor was very good, that she's also sister. And when she saw my situation, she didn't tell anything. She went inside the room and she sat for 5 minutes and she came and she did something and more. And there was a moment of leg way of my daughter. She took it inside And 1 week I was completely in the bed rest and everything was fine. Then when I got delivered, no, so that time she came and she only did the delivery. And she came after that, we were in the post-operative room and she came to see and she saw there were almost 8 to 10 deliveries were done on that particular day. But my daughter, no, she was sleeping nicely. Even I was also healthy and she saw and she was shocked to see both of us with a good health condition. And she said, see, when you came last month, I was so confused what to do and your condition. I just went inside and I sat and I prayed. I prayed, God, what I can do, whom to say, whether the mom or the daughter it was. But both are with a very good health condition. You don't have any problem. God has blessed you with a beautiful baby also like that. And she went outside and she spoke to my parents. Both are healthy and nothing else. And just it is because of your family prayer and the whole assembly, the many our assembly people were also there during my delivery time. So because of your assembly members, your prayers, both are saved. So I was really, really, it is a shocking for me to see both are there. I thought there will be some problem or some health issues with the baby, but both really, they are healthy. But it is not the end. After 2 years, that means 2 years back, I underwent for a surgery. It was a major surgery, which we had not imagined at all. I had a cyst between, I had an adrenal cyst between kidney and the liver, right kidney and the liver. They told they are going to do the lapro. And they took me to the OT, operation theater, at 8:30. They told by 10:30, 11, it will be over. Only 2 hours, they said. But when I came out, it was evening 4:30. So it was a very shocking that really I'm alive today. It's just because of the prayer and by God's grace. Because they took me, it was by saying that it is going to be laparoscopy. But when they were going to do the lapro and they were pulling the drain, that cyst, it got eaten to the liver and I had an internal bleeding. So immediately they operated, they did the open surgery. And so as they were not prepared for the open surgery, it was just with general anesthesia, what the gas they were giving, it extended for 4 hours. Maximum they can give it for 2 hours, but they extended for 4 hours. So as the gas went inside, it converted to the liquid form and my right lungs got collapsed over there. So this operation became the major operation. I was not knowing anything. So they shifted to the post-operative room. Next day morning, the sisters came. They thought it is a lapro. So for lapro patients, they will heat so that gas can come out. So they were beating me like anything. They were adding on my wound and the stitches might have got loose. I was screaming like anything. Then one doctor came and said, see, this is not a lapro. This is a open surgery and it is a very major operation like that. Then after a few days, after 10 days, I got discharged. And they told me to come after 5 days to remove the get done with the stitches removed. But when they removed the stitches, by the time I came back, it got opened because it was not completely healed. Without noticing it, they removed the stitches. So it was so horrible. And I came back to my native also for the rest. So with the open wound only, I traveled with a 10 kilometers speed to my native, between 10 to 20 kilometers speed, we reached my native. So from Bangalore to native, usually it will take 4 hours. That day it took 7 to 8 hours to reach. And immediately I went over there, they saw and it was completely, the wound was opened. So nothing has healed, nothing has joined. Again, 10 days later, like after a week, they gave for the culture test, that is whether it is a septic or not. And when they got to know that there is no septic, again, I got done with the restitch and all. So there will be always ups and downs in our lives, but we have to be very clear and we have to be very firm enough that we have to go with the God and you have to be always trust in the Lord. In Psalm 56:3, when you're afraid, I put my trust in you. So when we are afraid, we have to put our trust in only with the God. God can do any kind of miracle in. He can heal you from all types of troubles. And so this I have understood. Even prayer is very important for your life. Prayer, prayer, prayer. So whenever we are going out, even if I'm taking my daughter out for park or to bring something, we will start with the prayer. So once we get ready, my daughter will come with her scarf and she will be get ready with the prayer. So prayer is very important. And another thing, whatever you're going to do, you have to do for the glory of God, and God will be with you. So last word, it says John 8:29, I always do those things that please him. So we have to do the things which is going to please God, and God is making us to take that those things in my mind, and we are walking according to the will of God. Do keep our family in your prayers. Let us be firm with the with God and his ministries. Thank you
so much, Soumya. That was a very beautiful testimony. I didn't know all this.
Yeah,
you had to go through the medical testings, the surgeries and all that. God bless you. And even as a youngster, when you got saved, but you didn't have the assurance, and again in the meetings you got saved. That's important. Thank you for what all you said regarding sharing. We need to have some mentors, you know, some spiritual guides who can really guide us sincerely, you know. So we need to have that. And also, God bless you for having a heart for ministry for the juveniles home you're going, and the jail ministry and the orphanage. God bless you. May the Lord bless your testimony, okay?
So thank you so much, Auntie.
Yeah, I know. So youngsters who all are in the Zoom session, I'm sure you're challenged by the testimony of Soumya.
Yeah, Auntie, I forgot to tell one thing. Most of us, we have the confusion. When we go to college, we do come across with the unbelievers, whether to speak to them, whether not to speak to them. Even when I was taking Sunday class, even few had asked about it. So those youngsters who are here, what I want to tell you is, you have to speak with your unbelievers. You have to make friend, but you have to keep your testimony. See, if you're not going to make friend, if you're not going to share the word of God, who is going to share? See, God is going to give your unbeliever friend. Means that means God wants to work with you. Through you, he wants to work. So you speak to them, you pray for them, or in case if they are not interested, at least you spend time in praying for yourself. Or there are so many youngsters who are blessed with a beautiful voice. You have got a very beautiful voice, the Rachel and all, they will be singing so nicely. So when you get the opportunity to sing in the college, you can sing the spiritual song. Through that, so many can accept the Lord. And with your friends, when you get time, you can be singing and you can teach them song. So you can utilize. And when I was in the college, or when I was going for the consultation in the clinic, I used to carry some handouts, so some magazines along with me. So they used to keep magazines in the waiting room. So I used to take all this and I used to keep and come. And I used to pray, God, let anyone take that magazine and read, and let they come near to you. So we can do this small things. And when I was traveling in the bus, so I was sitting, one blind girl was sitting next to me. I was speaking to her, and I was asking where you're going, like how you manage your things like that. Then she started sharing her lives and all. Then she said, then I asked her, don't you find difficult in managing things by yourself? Then she said, yes, I find it difficult. Then I said, don't worry, we'll pray. Immediately she asked, Akka, are you Christian? She asked. See, what testimony we are going to keep before others. Then I said yes, and I started sharing the word of God, and we exchanged the number. And I she called me one day, she had some problem at home. Then I told, I will send one brother to your home. He will come and he will pray for your mother, because her mother was sick. And I gave that number to one evangelist in Mysore. So he is the next part, is going to take care. Like, he is going to do the follow-up, he's visiting, he's praying. See, if you want to do something, God has given so many opportunities, but we need to utilize it. So you can utilize it also.
Yeah, that's right.
So thanks.
So we can use every opportunity to share the gospel. Okay, so God bless you, Soumya, for the wonderful testimony. Okay, now we'll just have a short Bible study, okay? I will not take long. I will just stop by 4:30. We'll just read two verses from the book of Job, 42nd chapter, okay, 13th verse. It says, he also had 7 sons and 3 daughters. And he called the names of the first Jemima, the second, the name of the second Kezia, and the name of the third Kerhempu. In all the land were found no women so beautiful as the daughters of Job, and their father gave them an inheritance among their brothers. After this, Job lived 140 years and saw their children and grandchildren for 4 generations. Okay, so here we are very familiar with the book of Job, and I'm sure the youngsters, you must have read in your daily portion, even as you journeyed through Genesis, maybe you read this book of Job, or maybe some of you skipped, whatever it is. I just want to bring to your notice one point, that is 42nd chapter, 14th verse. So Job, in the first chapter of Job was, Job lost everything, okay? He lost his family, he lost his inheritance, he lost his riches, everything he lost, okay? But then in 42nd chapter, we see that the Lord blessed Job again, okay? Because Job was, we see the definition of Job is he is a very righteous person. He was blameless and he was God-fearing, and he always used to shun evil. What does shunning evil means? Hating evil. He would not do anything which is not according to the word of God, okay? And that's the reason God blessed him abundantly, okay? Not only physically, but also spiritually. And in every areas, you know, because Christian life is a well-balanced life. Today we have 2 sisters, they're from St. Anne's, Blessy and her sister and her friend, you know, I think one of the girls, it's her birthday. So after the meeting, we'll just sing for her and pray for her also, okay? I just got reminded. So Job had, in the 42nd chapter, he had 3 young daughters, okay? And I'm sure all the people in the Zoom session right now are all young, right? We are all young in the Lord, and you are young physically, okay? So we see that Job was blessed again with 3 wonderful daughters. And what are their names? The first one's name is Jemima, and the second one is Kezia, and the third one is Kerempu, okay? And these 3 wonderful women, they were giving great testimonies. Remember, all these many weeks, we've been learning how youngsters need to keep up their testimony. Like how we just heard about Soumyaka's testimony. There were times when she was tempted. There were times when there were very hard times for her, where she has to face a lot of criticism, or even face a lot of opposition, where she needs to really take a stand for the Lord. So youngsters' life is not easy, because there are so many things which will trouble us. There's so many things which will bother us, right? And even no matter how hard we try to have a holy life, this world will never let us have it, okay? But whatever it is, we need to keep our eyes fixed on the Lord Jesus Christ. And that is the secret. Unless and until you do not fix your eyes on the Lord Jesus Christ, you will have a life of failure, okay? But Soumyaka, we just heard her testimony. Her life was full of success. She triumphed in everything. In every situation, she was a winner, right? So now we see Job had 3 sons, 3 daughters, okay? And their names was Jemima, Kezia, and Kerempu. And there are a few things which are written about these 3 women. It says in the 13th chapter, it says in 14th verse, it says, you know, and in all the land were found no women so beautiful as the daughters of Job. So the kind of testimony these 3 young women, daughters of Job, had, they were, you know, their lives were so beautiful. Their lives were not only, remember I told you, it doesn't talk about the physical beauty. See, even Soumyaka had told, even for a wedding, she never went to a beauty parlor, because the Lord has given us natural beauty, okay? We are beautiful from within. The Lord has given us good eyes, good mouth, good nose, and good face, and good countenance. And every day we need to look at ourselves in the mirror and say, hey, I'm so beautiful. Because we are designed and we are created in the image of Christ. So if any girl is there in the Zoom session right now who thinks you're not beautiful, put a full stop to that and tell yourself every day that I'm beautiful. You don't need any makeup. You don't need any lipstick. You don't need any, it will not increase your beauty, okay? So you have the spiritual beauty which the Lord has already given. So the testimony of these 3 young girls are, you know, all the people in that land where Job was living, they examined those 3 girls, you know, they examined and they watched their lives. Okay, and they watched how spiritual they are walking, how beautifully they are keeping up their testimony, okay? Because when they're youngsters in a house, suppose the three young, beautiful girls, I tell you, all women's eyes will be on that house. Like the bees on a honeycomb, right? But these girls have kept up their testimony. Children, I'm telling you, the life you're leading right now is not an easy life. It's a life full of temptation. It's life full of, it's life full of temptations. And you want to get into the world, okay? But what the testimony these three young girls had is, in all the land, compared to all the girls, how many girls will be there in a land, in a country? Suppose in India, how many girls will be there, young girls? Oh, there'll be thousands and thousands of them. Imagine these three young girls' testimony and their beauty and the way they behaved, the way they looked, the way they spoke, the way they behaved with others was so beautiful that there was no other girls like beautiful as the daughters of Job, it says, right? In all the land were found no women so beautiful as the daughters of Job. That means the only beautiful girls in that land were only these three people. Okay? And what beauty is that? It's the inner beauty. It's a spiritual beauty. It's the beauty you show when you talk to others. It's the beauty you show yourself when you're all by yourself. Number one, they were beautiful. Okay? And the second one is, and their father gave them an inheritance among their brothers. The second testimony about these young girls was they were given inheritance. What does inheritance mean? Property, right? Whatever the property Job was having, all the property, he divided into 10 parts, seven brothers and three sisters. So along with the brothers, these three young girls were given properties, okay? They were given land, they were given sheep, they were given buffalo share, they were given whatever they wanted, whatever they were worthy of, they were given, okay? So now what do we think? The first one is they were beautiful and they became very rich because their father gave them inheritance. And what is that inheritance? For God so loved the world that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. See, children, we are all youngsters. We are right now in the world, living in the world with all temptation, with so much of pressure on us, this pressure of exams, pressure of interviews, pressure of assignments, pressure of projects, pressure of so many things, right? These youngsters are always bombarded with so much of tension. So whatever it is, whatever we are living right now on earth is temporary. But once we are saved, see, even Soumyaka had told earlier when she received the Lord and she also got baptized. But later when she heard a brother speak, that is when she got born again. So when you are born again or when, because that means this says, in Job 42nd chapter, 15th verse, all the three girls were given inheritance, means they were given land. Okay. So I tell you, children, youngsters, all the property we have here on this earth. Okay. You might have trillions and billions. You might have 10 cars, fancy cars. You might have four houses. You might have a lot of gold, all that. When you die, when your heart says lub dub, lub dub, lub dub. In this Sunday school story, it seems a young heart, remember our heart, right? It says lub dub, lub dub. I told you earlier, I don't mind telling it again. So our heart says lub dub 72 times a minute, okay? And between a lub and a dub, there's a small fraction of a pause, okay? Our heart says, it doesn't say lub dub, lub dub, it doesn't say that. It says lub and takes a pause and says dub again. Again, it says lub and again it says dub, right? So between every lub and dub, there's a small pause, okay? And the Sunday school story is every time, okay, because this heart pace, it's called the pacemaker, okay? It's called the heartbeat. So the Lord who created your heart, when you were 3 months old in your mother's womb like a fetus, he put that pacemaker, he put the heartbeat, okay? And from that day till now, this our heart created by God is faithfully looking at the Lord. Every time it says lub, that gap, it looks up and says, Lord, I am Soumya's heart. Should I say lub? He says, say lub. Again, the dub. Again, it says, Lord, I am Annie's heart. Should I say dub? So it's a story, Sunday school story. Every minute, our hearts looks to the Lord 72 times. And one fine day, the Lord will say, stop saying lub. And then what happens? We die, right? So when we die, whatever property, whatever things, whatever inheritance, whatever lands and whatever cars and everything we earned here, we are going to just leave and we are going to go, right? You've seen all the great film stars have died. They're filthy rich, okay? They are so rich that they have millions and trillions of money. But when they died, they left everything, okay? And go to see their unbelievers, directly they go to hell. But what about you and me? When we die, we go to heaven, right? So these girls, that Jemima Kezia and Kerhempu, all three of them were given properties. Today, what is the property we have? What is the inheritance? What is the gift? It says in Romans 6:23, right? For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. So the Lord is giving us a gift. And what is that gift? Eternal life. And what is that eternal life? He's giving us heaven as a gift, right? Here we see in the book of Job, 42nd chapter, 15th verse, Job, the father, the earthly father, gave the daughters inheritance, gave the daughters gift, okay, and gave the daughters land as a gift. But our heavenly father, what gift he gave? When he came to this honor, when he came to this earth, he died, you know, he shed his blood, he got nails pierced in his hands, and he died in your place so that you and I could be blessed, okay? And by dying on the cross, what did he give us? He gave us inheritance in the heavenly places, right? So today, as Jemima and as Kezia and as Kerempu, we are beautiful in the Lord, okay? Say yourself, I am beautiful. And the second one is, we are given inheritance. I tell you, today, if the Lord was to come here right now, this moment, how many of us are ready to go to heaven? I am ready, okay? It's not because of my good works. It's not because of what good I have done. It's basically because of God's grace, okay? So eventually, next week, we'll in detail learn about the character of Jemima, learn the character of Kezia, and even learn the life character of Kerhempu. But for today, they were given, the second point is, they were given inheritance by the Father, okay? And today, our Heavenly Father is ready to give us inheritance. And what is that inheritance? Salvation, right? So he's given us salvation, and he's given us in the book of Revelation 22, we see the heavenly city, okay? When you and I are born again, when we give our heart to the Lord, when we confess our sins, and when we say sorry to the Lord for all the sins we have done, and when we invite Jesus into our hearts, he gives us heaven as a free gift. I tell you, children, many youngsters, you know, of your age, they make a commitment to receive the Lord. They make a decision to receive the Lord. But somewhere down the line, they have a lot of doubt. They doubt whether I'm really saved. They think they are saved, but they do not have the assurance of salvation. I'll explain in one small incident. Suppose you give me 1 rupee coin, okay? And suppose I have a pocket for this kurta. Okay, I just take that 1 rupee coin and I put it in my pocket, okay? So since it's a 1 rupee coin, it's a very light coin, I don't feel the coin is in my pocket, okay? So when you tell me after half an hour, Annie auntie, I gave you 1 rupee, where did you put it? I said, I don't know, okay? So though the 1 rupee is in my pocket, I do not feel it, okay? So the problem with youngsters is, though they listen to the gospel many times, though they make a decision to receive the Lord as their personal savior, though they can get convicted that they are sinners and they receive the Lord Jesus Christ, the problem is they don't feel they are saved. I tell you, children, salvation is not a feeling, okay? Suppose today my mom buys me a dress, I feel happy. And that happiness is only till I wear the new dress. After that happiness is gone. Can you imagine one dress which your mom has bought? Are you happy every time you wear it for the next 10 years? No. We're just happy the moment we wear it. We look at ourselves in the mirror with all poses. We'll take selfies and we're happy. And once we remove the dress, that happiness is gone. So salvation is not a feeling. It's a fact. Please remember this. Okay. So Kerhempu, Jemima and Kezia and Kerhempu, three wonderful, beautiful daughters of Job were given a property. They were given a gift. And today our Heavenly Father is making us beautiful for him and is giving us a property or giving us a gift in heaven. And that gift is salvation. Okay. And salvation is not a feeling. Don't go by feelings. For you to understand, I'll give you one little incident and I'll stop, okay? There were three people walking on the wall. Remember, next week I'll ask you, okay? There were three people walking on the wall, okay? The first one was feeling, okay? And the second one was faith. And the third one was fact, okay? Three people, three friends, I'll tell you. The first friend's name was feeling. And the second friend's name was faith. And the third friend's name was fact, okay? Three of them were walking on the wall. Feeling, faith, and fact, okay? They were walking. And after some time, you know, feeling, you know, when do we feel happy? Suppose you give me a big glass of thumbs up, I feel happy. Once I gulp it down, my happiness is gone, okay? So the feelings and emotions are temporary, okay? So one day when you really pray good, you know, you feel very happy. Suppose you help a poor child by giving some gifts, you know, you are happy, okay? So then after these three men were walking on the wall, feeling, faith, and fact, okay? So after some time, you know, feeling got tired and he said, hey, come on, man, this walking on the wall is so boring. So he fell down. Okay. So once the feeling fell down, who started walking again on the wall? Tell me. Faith and fact. Okay. Faith and fact, they're walking again. After some time, because the feeling fell down, okay, this fact also, this faith also thought, oh, come on, this feeling fell down. No, even I'll fall. I don't want to walk. So fall, faith also fails. Okay. But the fact kept walking again. What is fact? Fact is nothing but the truth. Jesus said in John, I am the way, the truth and the life. Okay. Truth will never fall. Suppose you tell me, Annie auntie, okay, okay, California is not in America. You tell me, okay. Is California in America? California is a state in the country of America. You tell me that, Annie auntie, California is not a part of America. Then I will think for some time and I'll say, okay, yeah, Percy told me that California is not a part of America, or maybe it's not a part of America. But whether Percy believes or no, whether I believe or no, the fact is California is in the country of America. Okay. So the fact doesn't. So then Percy will say, Annie auntie, I feel that California is not part of America. Then I'll think, oh yeah, maybe. So fact doesn't follow by feelings, right? So fact kept walking. Okay. Fact does not fall. Fact will never falter. I tell you, children, the plan of salvation, the reason why Christ has come to this world, it's a fact. And nobody, whether somebody believes or no, or even in the world, nobody believes in Lord Jesus Christ. Yet the fact is that the Lord Jesus Christ is the savior of the whole world. And there's no other name given among all gods except Jesus. Okay, and his name is above all names, and every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess. Then he say, hey, no, I won't believe. Whether you believe in Jesus or no, the fact is Jesus is the savior of the world. It's a fact, okay? So fact kept walking for some time. Then once the faith saw fact walking, you know, again faith came up, started walking. Once faith came up, started walking, feeling also came up, and all three of them continued in their journey. Children, today, the fact is Jesus saved you. Jesus likes you and he loves you. And he gave himself as a ransom so that you and I could go to heaven. Okay. So as many youngsters, they have a lot of doubts. You know, I just tell four doubts, you know, youngsters, why you do not have the assurance of salvation. Why you do not believe yourself that you're saved. The reason why you don't believe is, number one, okay, we think, many people think that I made a decision in VBS when auntie was telling me the Bible story. I raised my hand and I gave my life to the Lord. But Akka, after that, my anger is not gone. After that, my jealousy is not gone. My lies are not gone. I'm not good enough. I'm not doing good works. Okay, the first lie or the first deception lie which Satan tells you that you're not born again. He says, you know, you are not good enough. He says, you have to be perfect to go to heaven. Children, nobody is perfect. You talk to the biggest pastor in the world. You tell him, you ask him and go, uncle, are you perfect? He says, no, my child, I'm not perfect. I'm in the process of getting into perfection, right? So the first sin or the first lie which Satan tells you, so that you don't have the assurance of salvation is, he tells you in Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, he says, you are not good enough. But the Bible says, salvation is not of good works, but it is the grace of God, okay? So the first lie, I'll just tell you four lies. And the next lies, what Satan tells you, so that you will stop yourself from assuring yourself that you are born again. Okay. The first one is Satan says you're not good enough. Okay. And the other one is many immature Christians have not disciplined themselves to grow in all aspects into Christ. In Ephesians 4, 11 and 15, it says, come on now. You have to, once you're born again, you have to be so perfect. Okay. You should not get angry. You should every day read 10 chapters of the Bible. You should pray for 1 hour. Why you didn't pray for 2 days, 1 hour? Come on, you're going to hell. So Satan will tell us that you are not perfect. I tell you, children, we'll never be perfect. Okay. So the first one, he says, you don't have good works to go to heaven. And the second one, he says, you're not perfect. Okay. You're not disciplined. Today you have not prayed, so you'll go to hell. Okay. That's the second lie he tells. And the third one, it says, you know, in James 1:22, it says, you know, you listen to the word of God. Satan will say, don't listen. Satan will not say, don't listen to the word. He says, you listen to the word, but don't obey. Okay, that's why the Lord said, do not just be hearers of the word, but the doers of the word. So Satan will let you listen to the word, but he will not let you put that word into practice. Okay, that is the other one. And also, fourth lie he says, come on, man, look at that person in your church. He's born again and is baptized, but still see, he's not perfect. So he'll make you look at others with all their mistakes, and he'll tell you, because they're born again and baptized, there are so many mistakes in them. So that's the fourth lie. He says, you cannot be perfect, okay? And that's the reason, no matter how, even if you take baptism, you will not go to heaven. So he tells you this lie. I tell you, Jemima and Kezia and Kerempu, the daughters of Job, were given property. They were given a gift by the Father. And today our Heavenly Father gave us gift, okay? And what is that gift? Salvation. And many children, youngsters, you know, though they're saved, they do not have the assurance of salvation. And the reason why we do not have assurance of salvation is because Satan tells us all lies, you know. The first one is, he says, we are not good enough, okay? He says, we are not good enough. And the second one, he says, we are not perfect enough. And the third one, he says, look at others, they're not perfect. So he tells you all these things. You're not perfect, he says, but we are not perfect. In spite of not being perfect, the Lord will help us to go. He loves you so much. He thinks you're of great honor. He thinks you're such an awesome child. And he did everything on the cross for you so that you and I could land up in heaven. So we'll continue this lesson on assurance of salvation and also the life characters of the daughters of Job, that is Jemima, Kezia, and Kerempu. May the Lord bless this word. Okay, if Blessie and her friend, I forgot her friend's name, if they are there, please open your videos. We can pray for you. Are you there, Blessie?
Hello, auntie. I'm there. But my friend, she wasn't available to attend this meeting, so she didn't attend.
Okay, but tell her that we wished her, okay?
Yeah, sure, auntie, sure.
And next week also, please log in, okay?
Okay, auntie, sure. Thank you.
I'll pray for her all. Okay, I'll pray for her also, okay? We'll say a short prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we praise and we worship your name, Lord. We come to you once again, thanking you for all the wonderful things you have done for us, Lord Jesus. Many youngsters are yet to come, Father. Maybe they have exams. Some of them have, Lord Jesus, online classes, and some of them are just, Lord Jesus, staying at home and not logging in, Father. But we thank you for the ones who have come, Lord. We especially pray for Lord Jesus Soumya, for her wonderful testimony, Lord Jesus. Even from the time she was a youngster, she has explained us how she depended more on you, Father, and also how, Lord Jesus, she depended on spiritual guides, Father. We thank you. In everything, Lord Jesus, she had great desire to go to the jails and juvenile homes, Lord Jesus, and minister the word of God, Lord. And also regarding her marriage also, she wanted her future husband also to encourage her in the ministry, Lord. We thank you for that, for all the talent she's got, Lord, and what a wonderful testimony, Lord. During pregnancy, there was a problem, and after pregnancy also 2 years back, she had so much trauma, Lord Jesus, during the operation. But thank you so much for giving her the grace to stay alive, Father. Be with Michelle and Dawn also, even as the whole family lives for you, Father. Thank you for the wonderful testimony also. We thank you, Lord. Very briefly, we have learned about the daughters of Job, Lord Jesus, in the 42nd chapter of the book of Job. All the three daughters were beautiful among the whole land, Father, and the Father has given them inheritance. Yes, Lord, as your children also, we are beautiful, Lord Jesus. And what a face we have, Lord Jesus. What a beautiful countenance we have. Not only that, Lord, you as our Savior, you have given us inheritance in heaven, Father. You've given us heaven as a gift for us, Lord. And Lord, when we are saved, Father, many youngsters do get into the trouble of, Lord Jesus, not believing and not having the assurance of salvation, Father. They really doubt if they ever land up in heaven, Father, because Satan tells them, Lord Jesus, it's of good works, and because you do not do good works, you will land up in hell. Also, he talks about perfection, Lord Jesus. You're not perfect, he says, and that's why you're not fit to go to heaven, he says. And he shows all other church people in the church, Lord Jesus, who are so, Lord Jesus, frail and who are so weak. And he tells, because they're not perfect, even you cannot be perfect, he says, Lord Jesus. So forgive us, Lord Jesus, everybody in the Zoom session, Lord Jesus, help us to have the assurance of salvation, even as next week, God willing, we're going to in detail discuss about the assurance of salvation, Father, and the gift of heavenly and the gift of the heaven you have given us, Father. Thank you so much for blessing his friend, Lord Jesus. Today it's a birthday. Thank you, Lord, that Blessie was able to join. Give the other friend, Lord Jesus, your grace. Lord, many more such birthdays. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for every youngster who has zoomed in. who has logged in. This we ask in the most precious name of our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.